When it comes to reliability of any performance or racing engine, making sure that the lubrication system remains reliable is essential if the crankshaft and bearings have any chance of leading a long and healthy life. And when it comes to the top shelf of lubrication systems, this of course is a dry sump system, where the oil is literally evacuated out of the sump, stored in a remote reservoir, and then pumped back through the engine. This ensures that there's always a ready supply of high pressure engine oil, regardless whether the car's accelerating, braking, or cornering. Now, we're here with Bill from Dailey Engineering to talk about another aspect of the dry sump system, and this is the potential for a dry sump system to also improve engine performance or engine power. So Bill, I think there's a lot of confusion about this topic and maybe a lot of misinformation, but let's just start with one of the products that you showed us off camera before this interview, which was your simple bolt-on dry sump system for a crate LS engine. Can you tell us, with that sort of system on a crate engine, would you expect to pick up any power, and if so, how much?
Well, we've done some experiments where we do back-to-back crate motor, remove, install, and test, and somewhere between 15 to 16 horsepower gain. It depends on the end user and what they do and how they install it in the car and the system. Some of it comes down to if we can make crankcase vacuum, or some run them open, don't make vacuum at all, and they just install them that way. So you can make vacuum. That's what's one good thing about our dry sump systems. But it depends on the power level and which system you actually run.
All right, so there's a few things that you've talked about there that I want to jump back in and unpack in a little bit more detail. But first of all, can you just tell us with that system, whether you're pulling a vacuum or not, where do you see the improvement in power, so 15, 16 horsepower, where's that coming from?
Well, the biggest gain is getting oil out of the motor, off the crankshaft, so there's no windage hit of the crankshaft rotating in a heavy, misty oil volume. Making vacuum in the motor does a couple of things. It like the density of the air goes down, so the windage is less. But the biggest benefits that you get is keeping the pressure differential across the rings down, so that on the intake stroke, we keep the minimum amount of oil getting across the rings into the combustion chamber, and that burns oxygen. And if you burn oxygen, there's less oxygen to burn the gasoline. So that reduces horsepower.
All right, so what you're talking about there is during that intake stroke where essentially we've got a low pressure area inside the combustion chamber or above the piston, and by reducing the pressure in the crankcase, you're helping to mitigate that oil making its way from the crankcase up past the rings and into the combustion chamber?
Correct. It's the pressure differential across the rings.
Okay, so when we're talking about this, is it fair to assume that getting that pressure differential or reducing the pressure or making more vacuum in the sump is going to be beneficial, or is there a point where that starts becoming irrelevant?
It becomes irrelevant depending on the ring seal and the tension on the rings. So a crate motor has got pretty moderately high ring seal, and they seal very, very well, very low blow by. So making vacuum on a crate motor is really not that beneficial. So most of our power gain there is coming from the windage inside the crankcase. Now, if we build a motor and we put lighter tension rings or ultra light tension rings in, then we got to make the rings work better or help them work better to keep the oil from migrating across the ring seal into the top end. But a big power gain there is the frictional content of the rings reduces the horsepower drag in the motor, and that's a big gain in the horsepower.
So again, just to unpack that a little bit, what you're talking about there is the radial tension that the rings apply outwards onto the cylinder wall. And of course, particularly during that intake stroke, we're really relying on that radial tension of the rings to prevent the oil migrating up into the combustion chamber. So by reducing or creating a vacuum at least in the crankcase, this allows you to then fit lower tension rings, which then allows less frictional losses without the oil making its way into the combustion chamber. Is that sort of a good way of sort of breaking that down?
It is. The lighter the tension, the more vacuum the rings need to make them seal. And the higher the tension, the less they do.
Now, in terms of that vacuum, though, is there a point where too much vacuum actually can be a negative effect on the engine? Can we go too far?
The one drawback is you can suck blow-by gases from the piston, by the rings, through the wrist pin bore interface. And what that does, puts hot exhaust gases down the wrist pin bore, blows the oil out of the interface, and that's the term sucking the wrist pins dry. So that can burn up wrist pins. It depends on the ring tension, how much blow by, the motor, the build, the power level. So drag races usually want as much vacuum as I can give them. I mean, there's no such thing as too much. Road racing, we usually aim for 12 to 14 inches. and then the motor builders define what they want in between. So each builder is different. We tune the systems accordingly, and there's no right or wrong. There's just no magic. You deal with it, you define it, and then you tune it.
Yeah, you've talked about the danger there for the wrist pin. Is there also the potential to end up actually sucking air in through, let's say, the front and rear crank seals?
Well, if you have too much vacuum, you can crack them open. A factory seal it's effectively a vacuum regulator. It's a spring-loaded lip seal. And so based on the diameter, the smaller they are, like the front main seal on an LS, will crack off around 12 to 13 inches of vacuum. The rear main seal will crack off because it's bigger. Front main seal around 18 inches. If we change those out and we put in a real good, like an allied seal, Teflon lip seal, they're pretty much good for any vacuum. So they won't leak off. If I have a crate motor and I run too much vacuum and I suck air in through the rear main seal because I have too much vacuum and I run a clutch, well, that clutch does is going to end up inside the seal and inside the motor. So
that's pretty abrasive. So you don't really want that inside your engine, yes?
Correct.
Okay, so in terms of actually controlling or regulating the amount of vacuum that you're producing inside the engine, how are Dailey doing that? What's the design elements that go into your particular systems to suit a certain application?
Well, the pump's always made to be the max possible. To regulate it down, you can do two things. You can run an orifice in the valve cover, and that's a flat vacuum decrease across the board from idle to max RPM. The better scenario is a vacuum regulator. So you can set it at 12 inches, 13, 14, as much as you want, but you can only set it as high as the pump will give. So if I have a pump that'll make 18 inches and I set it at 12, then the pump can degrade over time, but it won't go lower than 12. If it does, either the pump's going away really bad or the motor's blow-by is increased and the motor's going away. So that's a real good way to regulate it down and control it to the vacuum levels that the engine builder wants and is tunable.
This is probably a good time, just because of what you've just mentioned there, to talk about monitoring the vacuum, or at least the pressure inside the crankcase. So do you feel that's a good way of monitoring your engine health, getting an idea of how well the rings are sealing, or if there's potentially some catastrophic engine failure that may be imminent?
Absolutely. The misconception is I run a Dailey pump, but they don't know which one they have, so they seal the motor, and they just figure, well, we're making vacuum. But not every pump's accordingly correct for the motor. And what I recommend, just like you'd monitor oil pressure, if you have an oil pressure issue, it shows up, pressure degrades over time, you got a motor issue. If I'm gonna seal the motor and make crankcase vacuum, I wanna know what it is. And it's the health of the motor. As it goes away over time, it's giving you an insight as to, hey, maybe there's something going wrong in the motor. Pay attention, you know, be aware of what's going on.
Just in terms of the number of stages that you include on a pump, and we were talking about the stages, you've got the main pressure stage, and this draws the oil from the reservoir and actually pumps it through the engine, but then you've got the scavenge stages as well, which could be one single scavenge stage drawing the oil out of the crankcase and returning it to the reservoir, or of course you can have multiple scavenge stages. So you can talk to us a little bit about how you decide how many scavenge stages are right for a particular application.
Well, we find like on a V8, you have four bays. So we use divided oil pans, and there's one section per bay. So that's four scavenge sections, mandatory. And then you have a pressure pump. You could have optional turbo scavenge section, an added vacuum section, and they have lines that we just go up to the valve cover. So there's no right or wrong. And then we have our same LS pan, but with a production-based system. It's designed to fit in a Corvette. So now I have a motor mount and a rack that I got to fit in. And it's a three-stage pump, same V8 motor, but it's got to be compromised. So I combine bays 1 and 2 together and bays 3 and 4 together to make it a simple three-stage pump. So no right or wrong, but it's what it has to fit into is what drives the design.
I think it's probably really easy to lose sight of the fact that, particularly if you're looking at a five-stage pump, they do tend to get quite long. And as you've mentioned, making that fit and work in a production engine bay without modifying every other element of the engine mounting can be quite complex. Now, the other topic you mentioned there is about the divided bays. And again, there's a little bit of misinformation out there, I think, in general about whether it's best to have these bays sealed completely. So essentially, each pair of cylinders and the V8 is sealed from the next pair. Is this essential? Is it beneficial or is it detrimental in your opinion?
Well, there's no right or wrong again. So I've done quite a few motors where we've been designed to seal the base And every time I've ever done it, I've lost power. And when I picked up the power, I've opened it back up to let the bays breathe between each other. So I'm a big fan of let the bays breathe. But if you look at a very specifically designed race engine like a kart, they're all sealed, divided and sealed. But they get to spend billions of dollars designing, developing those motors specifically, where we build aftermarket products that bolt on everybody's motor. So I try to do generic things at a very high level on a production-based level systems. And again, I've found that letting them breathe together is better than sealing them off.
All right, look, Bill, that's been great to get some real good insight into your systems there and how it's possible to actually make some additional power along with adding reliability to your engine. If people want to find out more about your products, how can they reach out?
Well, our website is www.daileyengineering.com. It's the name Dailey Engineering, all spelled out, all one word. If we got a phone call, you can call. I'm always there, and we're willing to listen and talk.
Great. Thanks for your time, Bill.
Thank you, guys.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.